Welcome to the meeting of the panel on environmental affairs. It's the appointed time and we have a quorum. Item number one, information papers issued since the last meeting. Since the last meeting, members did not receive any information papers. Item number two, items for discussion at the next meeting. The next regular meeting will be held on August the 23rd, which is a Monday at 2:30 p.m. There are two discussion items. A, public consultation on the scheme on regulation of disposable plastic tableware. And this is something addressed by the Secretary earlier. Item B, ameliorating noise problems in public places and domestic premises and wider use of innovative technologies to manage environmental noise. Any comments from members? If not, these items will be confirmed. On August the 17th, the panel will arrange a visit for members to the waste management and cycling facilities, including O Park, T Park, and Tuen Mun Green Community Station. More than eight members have signed up, and those who still wish to join can sign up by 5 p.m. today. Item number three, Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong 2035. We now invite the administration in. With us today, our Secretary for the Environment, Mr. Wong Kam Seng, the Undersecretary, Mr. Che Chin Wan, and representatives from the Environmental Protection Department. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. Secretary, when you are ready, please. Chairman, today we will brief members on the Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong 2035. The Hong Kong roadmap on popularization of electric vehicles was announced earlier in the year. And in March this year, the government announced the first Hong Kong roadmap on popularization of EVs to set out the long-term policy objectives and plans to promote and adopt EVs in Hong Kong to achieve zero vehicle emissions before 2050. And in June, a progress report was announced, and the latest objectives under the Clean Air Plan were also published. In order to reduce emissions from vehicles, vessels, etc., by 2020, Hong Kong had already achieved all the main objectives set out in 2017 as for the atmospheric and roadside air quality. There were substantial improvements, of which the concentrations of respirable suspended particulates and sulfur dioxide went down substantially. The Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong 2035 sets out the policies and measures with a goal to make Hong Kong a more livable city with air quality on par with major international cities by 2035. And to achieve that, different policy bureaus would work together to make Hong Kong a more livable and low carbon city so that we can achieve our vision. There are a number of measures under the plan that are related to emission reduction. Now my team will walk members on the salient points under the Clean Air Plan. Chairman, the new Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong 2035 carries the measures that would be taken out by the SAR government leading up to 2035, and there are relevant targets and policies like the Secretary suggested, the first Clean Air Plan was published in 2013. It was known as the Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong. In 2017, we published a progress report, which was a continuation of the first report. Since the first Clean Air Plan was promulgated, a number of control measures were rolled out on emissions from vehicles, vessels, and power generation. And in terms of atmospheric and roadside air quality, there were substantial improvements for NO2 and RSP concentrations. They went down by 50%, while SO2 concentration went down by about 40%. In terms of visibility, there was also substantial improvement during the same period. In 2020, there were 346 hours with low visibility, compared with 1,570 hours in 2004. The reduction was almost 80%. And that shows that visibility improved substantially over the past 10 years or so. Meanwhile, such improvement brought about health benefits for the public. Compared with the year 2015, by 2025, with the consistent improvement in air quality, premature deaths and hospitalization cases would come down. Since the blueprint was published and the implementation of various emission reduction measures, by the year 2020, Hong Kong was able to meet the major targets established in 2017, of which air pollutants arising from roadside pollution and vessel emission went down substantially by 40%, and the use of coal in the power fuel mix went down to 24%, and the percentage of generation by LPG and renewable and nuclear energy went up, and overall the fuel mix became cleaner. In the new blueprint, we set out our vision, that is to make Hong Kong more livable, facilitate a low carbon transformation, and align ourselves with major international cities. And the goal is to make Hong Kong a more livable, low carbon city. The objectives we established were forward-looking. We will take out a series of measures and work with other Greater Bay Area cities, and we are confident that by 2035, air quality in Hong Kong will be on par with major international cities, and the ultimate target is for air quality in Hong Kong to fulfill the ultimate targets established by the World Health Organization. Of the 12 air quality objectives in Hong Kong, half of them have attained or achieved the ultimate targets set by the WHO, and we will review the AQOs every 5 years, and we will gradually comply with all the WHO ultimate targets in terms of air quality. With years of efforts, Hong Kong's air quality is gradually aligning with international standards. But in order to align our air quality on par with major international cities by 2035, we still face three major challenges. First of all, roadside NOx emissions is still rather high. We also have to reduce vessel emissions, and we need to tackle the high level of ozone as well. There are six major action areas in the blueprint, and these cover different areas. These include green transport, a more livable environment, emission reduction, clean energy, scientific management, and regional collaboration. And I will explain these six areas one by one. First of all, green transport. the government will continue to promote new energy transport and refine the green transport network. The government will continue to pursue the Hong Kong roadmap on popularization of EVs established in March this year. Our goal is to achieve zero vehicle emissions by 2050. Meanwhile, the government will continue to refine railway development and develop a green transport network. The government will continue to promote green transportation and introduce some green elements in new developments and in harbor and outlying island ferry routes. We will continue to trial electric and hybrid ferries. The second work area is a livable environment. To achieve that, we will work on urban management and provide health information. Some written submissions were submitted to the panel before the meeting, and they support the government's efforts. We hope to achieve a more livable city by improving air quality. The government will continue to promote a pedestrian-friendly and bike-friendly policy. And we are also revising the code of practice on air quality at public transport interchanges. And in terms of health information, in 2030, the government will revise the air quality indicators or air quality health index, and we will conduct a long-term study on the impacts of air pollution on the population. The government will continue to reduce emissions from all fronts, including vehicular and vessel emissions. For vehicles, the government is phasing out old diesel commercial vehicles. By the year 2027, we will phase out Euro 4 diesel commercial vehicles. We are also providing a subsidy on franchise buses on emission reduction devices. For vessels, the government will explore further tightening the cap on vessel fuels, and the sulfur content would be limited to no more than 0.001%, and new emission standards would be established on newly sold diesel vessel engines. For volatile organic compounds or VOCs, by 2024, the cap on VOC content in architectural paint would be tightened, and the control would be expanded to cover cleaning products. On clean energy, we will continue to reduce emissions arising from power generation, and we will explore a new low-carbon generation strategy. A new Hong Kong Climate Action Plan will be announced to set out the new clean air policy. In the next 10 years, power plants would gradually use LNG to replace coal, and the government will continue to explore the use of zero carbon power generation. And in order to promote hydrogen energy, an interdepartmental working group was set up to prepare Hong Kong for the use of hydrogen power. And at ocean-going vessels, the use of LNG has been tested, and within the next few years, relevant safety regulations and codes would be drawn up. We note that a number of stakeholders and the trade have welcomed this idea. The fourth action area is scientific management. This has always been the basis in improving air quality. The government will continue to use advanced technology to monitor air quality and to publish more detailed information to the public. We will continue to develop a smart air quality monitoring system, and we will conduct short-term air quality studies and analyze the air pollutants starting next year. At our air quality monitoring stations, we will be monitoring the VOC concentrations.
Point number six, a very important point, regional collaboration. The Hong Kong SAR government and the Guangdong provincial government have been collaborating on improving air quality. We'll continue to set out common indicators and will conduct joint monitoring in the PRD region. And we will be formulating the emission reduction plans and targets for 2025 and 2030 for the region. As for ozone, the two governments have launched a joint study to monitor air quality so as to have a better idea of the ozone pollution and to provide a scientific backing for formulating policies on regulating ozone pollution. On air quality monitoring, this has also been included as a standing item of monitoring by the three governments in Hong Kong, Guangdong, and Macau, and we will also use light detection and ranging technology LiDAR as the to measure real-time concentrations of air pollutants, and we'll continue to hold seminars and workshops to facilitate exchange of views and knowledge. The six key action areas covers 26 short and medium to long term tasks. These are all included in the annex of our paper. The government will continue to collaborate with the community by introducing different measures to continue to improve air quality and reduce emission. We'll continue to enhance regional collaboration so that Hong Kong will continue to be a healthy city with low carbon emission, so that we can fulfill the mission of healthy living, low carbon transformation, world class. While seven members have indicated their wish to speak, each will be given 5 minutes. We start with Mr. Tony Chair. Thank you, Chairman. In relation to Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong 2035, we have a vision, we have timetable, strategies, and measures. Of course, we should support the plan. Apart from formulating a blueprint, I think what is important is for the public to actually feel improvement of air quality, especially roadside air quality. And I have a follow-up question. Roadside air quality is heavily influenced by vehicular emissions. So my point is on public transport, especially buses and minibuses. Page 2 of the paper sets out franchise bus low emission zones in three basic corridors, etc. We started some years ago, but we understand that in terms of the general indicators in Hong Kong, I understand that we are meeting the targets and the level of pollution has come down. But regarding the low emission zones you mentioned here, may I know the effectiveness? We started in 2015, and if the result has been very good, then why aren't we expanding the low emission zones? So that as a short-term measure, we can improve air quality and the public will feel such an improvement. As for buses, there is a feeling that these buses are quite old. So may I know about the rest of the buses outside the low emission zones? As for minibuses, some 4,000 buses have been retrofitted with LPG containers. But as I understand that these minibuses running on LPG have actually ceased production. And in 2002, you started a study on electric minibuses. At the time, it didn't come through, but perhaps the idea should be revisited nowadays. Finally, on vessel emissions. Now, you mentioned local vessels. What about ocean liners? May I know the progress, Secretary? In a moment, I will invite my colleagues to give you the technical details. But let me first answer Mr. Chair's question. Of course, we are mostly concerned about roadside air quality. In recent years, by phasing out old vehicles, regulating them, and trying new energy vehicles, we have been able to improve air quality. After publishing the Hong Kong roadmap on popularization of electric vehicles, we have been encouraging franchise bus companies to procure electric buses such as double deckers and also LPG light bus or other new energy buses in order to further improve air quality. Now I'll give the floor to my colleagues. In the past few years, we have been encouraging franchise bus companies to adopt low emission buses. At the moment, the majority of buses run on diesel, but our vision is that by 2025, we hope to achieve zero emission of all vehicles. And in order to achieve that, we need to promote the use of new energy, including electric vehicles and other forms of new energy vehicles. In March, after publishing the roadmap on popularization of electric vehicles, franchise bus companies have reacted very positively. In the coming few years, by 2025 that is, we hope that several hundred electric double-deckers can be introduced in Hong Kong. In the past few years, members might have noticed that single-deckers have been used and that the range for these electric single-deckers is actually on a par with diesel-operated buses. So may I reassure members that in the coming years, the franchise bus companies will be introducing electric double-deckers fulfilling the charging requirements, etc. And about hydrogen energy buses, we need to consider the safety aspects of the plan and that all codes and practices should be complied with for the 4,000 plus minibuses. In the past decade or so, we have been focusing on LPG light buses, but indeed, the manufacturer at the beginning of this year stopped manufacturing LPG light buses, but that is why we are rolling out a pilot scheme. And we've actually prepared the specifications and charging standards for Productivity Council. We're trying to map out the way and reaching out to different manufacturers with a view to producing these light buses by 2023. For vessels, we've been told by the trade associations that basically ocean-going vessels would turn to LNG as well, that is liquefied natural gas. So we are joining hands with different government departments to study how ocean-going vessels and commercial vessels could turn to LNG whilst in Hong Kong waters. Well, may I ask the government to tell me the objectives of studies and timetables about buses, light buses, ocean-going vessels, etc. Do you have a timetable or not? Because that's not possible to just say that you will do your best endeavor. Next, Mr. Kenneth Lau. The government published the Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong 2030 to improve air quality in order to safeguard public health and reduce healthcare costs in the community. Low carbon lifestyle is the international trend to make our city cleaner, and definitely I support meeting the international targets. On power generation, it forms a major source of pollution, especially for coal fire power plants. They cause serious pollution. It seems that you're encouraging the power companies to adopt renewable energy with the gradual decline in the use of coal in the fuel mix. Is there any way for the government to prevent power companies from transferring the cost of using new energy on consumers? And apart from LNG, is there any study the use of non-petroleum power generation, that is non-fossil fuel generation of power? Thank you for your question. Apart from promoting cleaner energy, greater use of renewable energy would help us meet the target of carbon neutrality by 2050. As mentioned in our report, we were able to meet the target laid down for reducing the use of coal in fuel mix. By 2020, we were supposed to reduce the proportion by 20%, and we're able to meet this target by reducing the use of coal while improving air quality. Natural gas is a global trend. It's a form of transitional fuel. But then our policy is that there should be stable supply, it should be environmentally friendly at an affordable cost. Hong Kong is an international city. In terms of electricity tariff, comparing to other metropolises, we are not expensive at all. But then we need to consider the affordability by the different sectors of the community. That is why the government made a funding allocation a few years ago to provide relief on the electricity charges. As for the way forward, there should be clearer explanation on how we achieve carbon neutrality by reducing the use of coal in fuel mix, and then we will have a diversified plan in order to strike a balance. In due course, we'll be rolling out the updated climate action plan for Hong Kong, and there will be a clear explanation. At this moment, apart from natural gas, we also support the two power companies for building an offshore LNG station to help Hong Kong. So, to help Hong Kong source LNG with more competitive pricing. These are ways that could help us strike a balance between the cost implications and environmental protection. Will the government consider adopting a greater percentage of non-fossil fuel means? Apart from liquefied natural gas that is relatively cleaner, we also have nuclear energy from Daya Bay and also renewable energy that can be generated locally. And as members may know, in the new territories, there are different districts that are covered under the feed-in tariff scheme. Participation rate has been good. In other words, we make use of the rooftop of new small houses in the new territory so that solar panels can be installed to generate clean energy.
Mrs. Withcott. Chairman, air pollution is a source of complaints by many people, especially roadside air pollution, and I have received numerous complaints in this regard. With a clean air plan and emission reduction measures, I'm sure these would be welcomed by everyone. That is why I support the government's clean air plan. I think timeline would be the crucial point of interest. That is whether we are doing things quick enough and whether our work is complete enough. My concern is that with study after study, eventually nothing is being done. And in terms of the timeline for the six main action areas, I agree with all of them in principle, and I find them much needed. In terms of green transport, however, I am rather disappointed because you are not doing quite enough. In terms of the short and medium term measures, they are not quite sufficient. Since roadside air quality must be improved, I represent the Smart City Alliance, and our members have been promoting the idea of green transport at different seminars. And when it comes to green transport, apart from the vehicles such as franchise buses, public light buses, or so on, you should transition to new energy models as soon as possible, and the current progress is very slow. For older diesel vehicles, if the government does not do something or legislate, then nothing would improve. When it comes to commercial vehicles such as PLBs and buses, in the transition to electric models or new energy models, what measures does the government have in place to speed up their adoption? For example, by way of legislation, that is the only way you can get things done. In terms of eliminating older diesel vehicles, the government has shown commitment, as we can see. In terms of smart transport initiatives, I think there's room for improvement as well. Green transport and smart transport should include the element of smart parking, as well as intelligent transport, that is the measurement of traffic lights, as well as traffic management. If congestion becomes more serious, pollution would also get worse, and more carbon emissions would result. So in essence, how can you provide sufficient parking spaces for drivers? You should negotiate the issue with shopping malls and private and public operators, but they are always reluctant to provide the information. So without legislation, there is no way you can achieve any result. Otherwise, the problem would simply drag on. In Shenzhen, apps are available to show parking vacancies, but there's no such thing in Hong Kong. And in terms of traffic lights management, something needs to be done as well, or else you would be stuck in trial after trial. So when would that finally be implemented in Hong Kong? Many cities have deployed such measures, and congestion has improved by 10 to 20%, so we can see that results could be attained. For the free flow system or free flow tolling system, that is not the only solution. So your work is lacking in terms of green transport. I hope the government would review the situation and come up with measures as soon as possible. You cannot wait another 5 to 7 years for the studies to complete. I would defer to Owen to talk about smart parking. They have been working with the transport department on that. In terms of promoting new energy vehicles or commercial vehicles, the New Energy Transport Fund has been providing support. Last month, we supported a number of companies in acquiring single-deck buses. So progress has been satisfactory, and hopefully we can expand our work. For companies that engage in food deliveries, they have procured electric motorcycles, and this can further contribute to the improvements in roadside quality in Hong Kong. We would invite the Transport Department to talk about smart transport. In terms of smart parking spaces, in new land leases, we have introduced provisions such that developers must provide relevant information on parking spaces. And with these new leases, we believe more information could be provided. As for smart traffic lights, we will proceed to a strategic or comprehensive transport study very soon. We are working with different R&D institutions on the design of such traffic lights, and to the CTS, we will come up with a blueprint on how we can implement smart traffic lights over Hong Kong, including at road junctions. The strategic study will also assess Hong Kong's traffic and transport developments leading up to the year 2050, and we will look at new technologies. For instance, vehicular Internet of Things, smart driving technologies, and how they can exchange information with smart traffic lights with a goal to improving congestion. In terms of the Internet of Things for vehicles, what kind of studies are you conducting, and when will results be available? According to our roadmap, the first edition of the roadmap will be available by around the third quarter of 2023, and we will proceed to public consultation. In other words, we have more than a year to go. Can you speed up the work as much as you can? Seven members are waiting to speak. So please limit yourself to 5 minutes. Dr. Loh Wai Kok, Chairman. A number of members talked about vehicles. Roadside air pollution in Hong Kong chiefly comes from vehicles. The EU announced that they intend to ban the sale of fuel vehicles by the year 2035. The SAR government must come up with concrete plans and measures to answer this international trend. 2035 is a long way to go, and we do not know what would happen between now and then, but we believe this is a trend. Hong Kong relies on imported vehicles, so the plans would be essential. The paper and slideshow today talked about LED lights and new lighting devices with improved energy efficiency. So this is something the government should pursue. That is LED street lights. Hong Kong is lagging behind our neighbors in this regard. But now we are starting to see LED lights on many roads. I'd like to know what the current coverage ratio is. That way, we can tell the progress of implementation. Towards the end of the slideshow, you talked about the importance of regional collaboration. When it comes to air quality, Hong Kong must work with neighboring cities, including those in the Greater Bay Area. A university study has been tracking the improvement in air quality in Greater Bay Area cities, and we can see obvious improvements year by year. I believe the Hong Kong SAR government will continue to coordinate with the GBA cities and seek collaboration. And a lot of people in Hong Kong might not acknowledge such improvements. Perhaps they would still think air quality is inferior on the mainland. So the SAR government should explain the current situation to the public, and they should explain the results of our collaboration with the GBA. Thank you. We will closely monitor the discussions at the EU with regards to the 2035 target. So there is still quite some time to go to forge a consensus. As for the EV roadmap for private vehicles by the year 2030, we will ban the sale of conventional private cars, and I'd like to report the latest progress. Last year, for every 100 first registered private cars, there was one EV, and this year the figure has almost doubled. That is, there was almost one EV every 5 newly registered PC. And in the coming years, we will pilot test different classes of vehicles for street lights. We will obtain more information from the Highway Department and report to members. As for regional collaboration, according to the blueprint, next year, we will establish a goal leading up to 2035 with the Guangdong Provincial Government. And we will educate the public on what the mainland government has done to improve air quality, including the use of hydrogen power and emission reduction measures. And we will announce such measures adopted in the GBA as appropriate. Mr. Peter Hsu, Chairman. We can see that the government has achieved results in terms of emission reduction. And by the year 2020, all the targets have been met or surpassed. In terms of visibility and health benefits, for the health benefits arising from improvement in air quality, the number of premature deaths went down by 1,900 cases. How did they come up with this figure? We made reference to the number of hospitalizations and the number of deaths according to statistics provided by the Department of Health, and these include cardiovascular diseases and respiratory diseases. We made reference to these figures as well as some overseas figures on risk assessment. And we compare these figures with the against the change in air quality annually. Does it mean that in recent years, with an improvement in air quality, less patients pass away due to cardiovascular diseases? By 2025, we will achieve an improvement, and compared with 2015, the number with go down by 1,900. By the year 2025, air quality will improve compared with 2015. We should see 1,900 less deaths compared with 2015. So you are going to, so you expect 1,900 less deaths by then.
As of 2019, we also made comparison with the figures in 2015 and found a reduction. By how much? I'll provide the figures to members afterwards, but I would say several hundred. Well, if we have actual figures about recorded deaths, why are you giving me estimates instead? How do you come up with the estimates? I'm sorry to say that, of course, I support environmental protection. Secretary, every time I see you, I praise you because environmental protection is the common refrain, and of course, you give a very good report card. Now, I may be repeating myself every time, but it comes with a cost. So despite the really impressive figures here, you talk about only the benefits. But what about the financial costs involved? May I know how much we spent on these measures in order to achieve these results? We need to collate the figures first, but broadly speaking, based on the blueprints we've already published, and let me put it this way, there is no service life limit for old diesel vehicles. But last term of government published a blueprint which set out extra payment and the service life limit of these vehicles. And indeed, a lot of money was dished out, $10 billion or $11 billion spent on phasing out the old diesel vehicles. And we're now proceeding with the next phase. For the relatively older diesel vehicles, we offer another extra payment scheme for them. It is important because, for example, we need to invest in the use of new energy for ferries and buses as well. And this is capital investment. Well, I'm not trying to discourage you, Secretary. Well, of course, your performance has been impressive. But I just want to emphasize that it comes at a cost. So you need to tell people that. You can't just tell people about the rose garden, and you need to tell them, as you support environmental protection, you are paying a price. Because otherwise, people would always ask for more without understanding the costs involved. Well, very often, Mr. Stephen Ho and I follow the same logic. Mr. Yu Siwing, Mr. Frankie, I'd like to follow up on Mr. Peter Chiu's question. You cited some figures here. We also know about the Public Health Research Institute of the Hong Kong University, which conducts a study every year, and the reduction in number of premature deaths and hospital admissions. And that's a study from Hong Kong University. The study also contains figures about economic benefits. Why doesn't the government invite them to work with you instead? Because like Mr. Peter Hsu said, environmental protection comes at a cost. Whilst we support protecting the environment, we need to understand the implications. Perhaps after switching to electric buses, there will be a fare hike in future. The government therefore is responsible for telling the public that this may be our way forward. Because when you change the fuel mix, we all know that electricity charges will inevitably go up, only that you are not leveling with the public yet. Anyway, my point is that about roadside emission for electric vehicles, you have one-for-one replacement scheme. By 2035, you will be phasing out diesel vehicles completely. Now, meanwhile, will you encourage put in place a one-for-one replacement scheme for diesel vehicles, say by offering tax concessions, and if you phase out old diesel or older private cars, you may enjoy the concessions earlier. For franchise bus companies, I understand one of them has announced the use of electric buses. The other company is trying hydrogen energy buses. This is in fact running in the streets in Europe, but we need to consider where we find the hydrogen fuel cell buses. For heavy vehicles, would you consider LNG vehicles? Definitely, the performance is better than a Euro 6 diesel vehicle in terms of emission. So when you consider, say, bunkering areas for ocean-going vessels, I have another question. That is about legislation in other places. I'll follow up on that. Now you have bunkering facilities in Hong Kong for ocean-going vessels. Will you also implement as a medium-term measure something for the heavy vehicles? The other point is you want to tighten the sulfur content for local of fuels for local vessels from 0.05% to 0.01%. I remember I once asked about the price difference. For in-harbor ferries, they're in dire straits. No one could shoulder the cost. Now, whilst the sector supports the government in introducing environmentally friendly measures, we need to make sure that suitable financial assistance will be provided to them. Do you have any idea? How about I defer to Deputy Director? Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Yik, for the questions. Regarding tax concessions for phasing out older vehicles, now, for electric private cars, the development is quite rapid. And we have 1+1 replace scheme. And for 90% of newly procured electric vehicles, they all come under the 1-for-1 replacement scheme. We do welcome other suggestions on adopting a greater use of new energy for our vehicles in Hong Kong. Now, Mr. Yik, for the other point, we had meetings with you, and we understand that if we're able to use LNG for local vessels, our ocean-going vessels, there is also room for heavy vehicles in Hong Kong. We understand that there is a large-scale such large-scale projects on the mainland. We need to have bunkering facilities on land for heavy vehicles. All in all, our direction is heading towards the greater use of new energy. The other point is about lowering the sulfur content of local vessel fuels. Last year, we explored the idea with the industry. We understand that if we adopt the greater use of low sulfur content marine diesel, the cost will be higher. So we'll take it step by step. We don't have a timetable. Just a simple follow up. On the 5th of June 2019, I asked the Environment Bureau about the use of biofuel. Let me recap. The last paragraph suggests that you will continue to adopt various measures to promote greater use of biofuel by various industries in Hong Kong, but it seems that there is no progress. My question is whether the factory or the manufacturing base in Hong Kong is folded up. Do you have any measures? It's a coincidence that this morning when we had an internal meeting, we happened to discuss this item. In fact, in recent years, through different means, the government has increased the application of biofuel in Hong Kong. But then after the meeting, we continue to exchange views and see if it is feasible. All right, my turn. I have three questions. Let me supplement. The points have already been discussed by members. It seems that on transport, green mobility for private cars, the progress is good for other forms of transport. I hope that you encourage a greater use of electricity. The other point is about EV charging at home subsidy scheme. I'm also a beneficiary. I understand that you have received applications from many housing estates. May I know the progress? Has it been oversubscribed? If it is, will you consider providing more subsidy to benefit more people? And will you consider introducing different car makers? Because at the moment, the choice is limited. Point number three, FSP roadside monitoring station. There was a fire in Stonecutters Island earlier. Some 2,000 tons of metallic waste got on fire. And for Kowloon West residents, they could smell the strong odor. There was no announcement. Still, there is a worry. Because the FSP level increased substantially. So will the EPD make announcements and prepare indicators in the future? Apart from the roadside air quality monitoring station in the future, will more real-time data be provided? For example, if the pollution index in a certain district is high, members of the public could get this information perhaps from a mobile app or the internet, so that if you have physical conditions, you should stay away from these districts. About the EV charging at home subsidy scheme, we have received a positive response. We expect to install 60 chargers at 60,000 spaces in 3 years. Now we have 100,000 spaces in 440 estates. And for some of these estates, they've reached the tendering stage. And the price information will give us a better idea of exactly how much is involved in installing EV chargers there, and whether the original allocation will be depleted. So we are getting ahead of ourselves in getting actual experience, and we will better support housing estates in installing EV chargers. Third question, the air pollution index because of the fire. We do make announcements on FSP data on our website. If the air quality health index is alarming, well, press release will be issued to alert the public. Usually, there will be a short-term surge of the FSP levels because of a fire, but the overall impact on the general public would be limited. In fact, after the fire last time, we considered or we reviewed the arrangement for disseminating information. In case of a large-scale fire in a dense neighborhood, we would consider disseminating information earlier. And in fact, in a previous occasion, when there was a fire in Aberdeen, we also made a public announcement alerting the public that because of the fire, there might be a surge in the levels of FSP. Is there room to improve the information dissemination mechanism?
We do disseminate real-time information currently. And in terms of fires, we would have to communicate with the Fire Services Department before information is disseminated. For major fires that would affect surrounding residents, we would issue press releases. The paper talked about scientific management. You mentioned a number of areas of work, and hopefully in the future, you can disseminate real-time information. Next, Mrs. Stephen Ho. My question is similar to the question asked by Mr. Peter Shiu. Of course, environmental conservation is always desirable, but there is a cost to be paid, and very little is mentioned in the paper. For members returned from functional constituencies, they might have different views compared with those returned by GCs. The paper talked about reduction of emissions from power generation, and that would lead to a rise in electricity tariffs. So we have some questions for the government in this regard. In terms of using low sulfur diesel fuel or biofuel, then you have to look at the available power generation units or diesel units. And in some cases, the premium associated with such fuels would be tenfold. So you cannot just ask the relevant trades to deal with the problem themselves. You talked about reduction of emissions from power generation and green energy, and these could lead to a rise in electricity tariffs. And for wind power plants, you could not install them offshore due to various constraints, and you could not install these plants onshore due to land constraints. For certain stakeholders, they might benefit. For instance, for those that engage in or operate recreational farms, basically the relevant areas will no longer be available for fishing. If you ask the fishermen to fend for themselves, it is not realistic. But if you simply offer compensation so that they could switch to a different trade or industry, then that would have consequences on other practitioners as well. But if you allow the fishermen to continue to operate vessels, that would be better for them skill-wise, and that would avoid any repercussions on other trades. We are not encouraging fishermen to stop being fishermen, but we have some 4,000 fishing vessels in Hong Kong, and if you designate an area in the future, 500 fishing vessels might be lost, and other environmental issues might arise. Secretary, while you pursue these green initiatives, you should try to identify win-win solutions for all. For the wind power plants and LNG projects, the fishermen do have complaints, but little has been mentioned by the government. So for the inevitable marine works that will be conducted in future, we hope you can consider this sector. For offshore wind power plants, they are a rather novel idea in Hong Kong. Some of the new green facilities might affect some stakeholders, so communication is very important, and we would seek to minimize the impacts on such stakeholders while allowing some of the trades or stakeholders to transition to another kind of operation. The two power plants are looking at potential sites for wind power generation, and there are certain site constraints, and we hope to communicate further with members at a later stage. If you auction the sites for wind power generation, the fishermen will certainly lose out. So you should afford extra marks for fishermen. That is, for people who are affected, you should give them priority. You said that with an improvement in visibility, premature deaths and hospital admissions would be reduced by 1,900 and 1,500 cases respectively by 2025. So you should weigh the pros and cons and consider the long-term impact. Mr. Kuai Kang. The paper talked about the 12 air quality objectives of the WHO, and half of Hong Kong's AQOs have already adopted the ultimate targets of the AQG. So what are the other half, and what is the reason that the ultimate targets could not be attained? Is there any difficulties in achieving those targets? You should be able to explain why you failed to achieve the remaining targets, but nothing was mentioned. So how could we know whether you have encountered any difficulties or how far we are from achieving those targets? So hopefully the missing information can be provided. Apart from vehicular emissions, concessions, and phasing out older diesel vehicles in terms of building a more livable environment, you talked about the need to build a more pedestrian-friendly and bike-friendly environment. The Environment Bureau would only take care of work under their own ambit, and they would have to collaborate with the Transport and Housing Bureau in some cases. The paper talked about the inclusion of cycling tracks in promenade developments. So in the eyes of the government, cycling is just a recreational activity for some people as a pastime. So this is very different from cases of people riding to work. Our roads are yet to be bike-friendly, and some people choose not to ride their bicycles to work since there is a lack of support on roads. So are you going to do more in this regard by working with other departments? In the Central and Western District, there will be a new promenade, and the same goes for North Point. And apart from these, there are no other cycling facilities on the island. And this is entirely different from the comprehensive cycling system in the new territories. So does the government have any new initiatives in place, or have everything been described in the paper already? I would invite Mr. Chair, the Undersecretary, to address some of the problems. In terms of the policy on bicycle, I would defer to the THB. In terms of the air quality objectives, in carbon monoxide, SO2, etc., we have fulfilled the WHO's targets, and we have to work on NO2, RSPs, etc., and ozone. So we have adopted ultimate targets of the AQGs for half our AQOs, and for the rest, we will gradually work towards the WHO's targets. For new development areas, we will provide for a comprehensive cycling network. We would encourage people to walk and ride their bicycles more often. Bicycles can serve as the last mile in connecting with other modes of transport. And for details, I would defer to the Transport Department. Like Mr. Liu said, we are working with the Development Bureau at new development areas to pursue a bike-friendly policy. For the Hongshoukyu NDA, we hope a lot more people would use their bicycles for commuting compared with other NDAs. So specifications like the width of the cycling track would be substantially improved at urban areas due to restraints. We do not encourage the use of bikes on roads. So we have been on this item for quite some time, and the government has explained their work in relation to the Clean Air Plan, and hopefully they can achieve better results and take on board members' suggestions. We move on to the next item. That is phase 4 of mandatory energy efficiency labeling scheme. Undersecretary, when you're ready, please. Chairman, from March to May this year, the government included new products under Phase 4 of the Mandatory Energy Efficiency Labeling Scheme, or MEELS, and we conducted a public consultation. We would report the outcome of the consultation today, and we will take in members' views with regards to phase 4 of the scheme. I would invite the MSD to brief members on the scheme.
Chairman Chang, members of the panel, good afternoon. On behalf of the EMSD unit, I'd like to brief members on the phase 4 of mandatory energy efficiency labeling scheme. Starting from 2009, the first three phases of meals covered 8 products, including air conditioner, refrigerating appliances, compact fluorescent lamps, CFLs, washing machines, humidifiers, TVs, and electric water heaters, induction cookers. And we've also, in this year, increased the energy requirement for certain appliances, and we expect to roll out the this phase in the second quarter of this year. According to information, as of 2020, for the 8 types of electric appliances in the first 3 phases, they accounted for 70% of the annual residential electricity consumption in Hong Kong. And it's expected that every year we can help consumers save close to 440,000 tons of CO2 emission. We're in the phase 4 of meals, and we propose to cover 3 more appliances: light emitting diodes, LED lamps, gas cookers, and gas instantaneous water heaters. Similar to the previous 3 phases of meals, for phase 4, when considering the coverage, we consider the energy consumption of products, overseas experience, testing standards, laboratories, and the potential of saving energy. Between March and May this year, the EMSD conducted a public consultation on the proposed products for phase 4 of meals. And there is general support for inclusion of the 3 additional types of products in phase 4, as mentioned. According to information of the 8 types of products account for 70% of annual residential electricity consumption, and gas accounted for 30%, and that's from Hong Kong Energy and use data. Now, the department proposes to expand the meal scheme to cover instantaneous water heaters and gas cookers to achieve greater efficiency. Together with the existing 8 types of products in the 3 phases of meals, the total electricity consumption for residential households will increase from 48% to 80%. As for overseas experience, in the mainland, Southeast Asian countries, and other countries, there are similar mandatory labeling schemes covering the 3 types of appliances that we mentioned. Now, regarding testing standards and laboratories in Hong Kong, mainland, and other economies, we have laboratories for testing LED lamps. For gas cookers, apart from the recognized laboratories on the mainland, we also have other labs preparing for the launch of the tests. After including these 3 types of products, we'll be able to save close to 5, 6, 8.8 megajoules of energy. That is equivalent to a reduction of 75,350 tons of CO2 emission. Similar to the previous 3 phases, the importers or manufacturers will be required to provide information such as testing results in order to get a reference number. And on the product itself, the designated label will have to be attached in order for the product to be supplied in Hong Kong, and no manufacturer should supply products without the prescribed energy labels. So these are the proposed labels, from the left for LED lamps, for gas cookers, and also for gas instantaneous water heaters. Similar to the previous 3 phases, after phase 4 of meals, come into effect, there will be a grand transitional period of 15 to 18 months. There are two types of exemptions. For products that have been manufactured in Hong Kong or imported into Hong Kong, such as gas instantaneous water heaters and gas cookers, they'll be exempted before. And also, for procurement contract that includes products in newly built premises, the product supply will also be exempted. And after the transitional period, importers or manufacturers will be required to attach the prescribed energy labels onto the products before supplying in Hong Kong. We expect that the second quarter of 2023 will start to implement phase 4, and it will be fully implemented by phase 3 the third or fourth quarters of 2024. As mentioned just previously, we reported details to the Energy Efficiency and Conservation and Renewable Energy Subcommittee under the EAC in February this year, and we completed the public consultation exercise between March and May this year. And after reporting to the members here, we will proceed to legislative amendment, and then the amendment bill will be tabled into the Council for scrutiny. As for amendments to the Code of Practice, the sector will be further consulted. We'll continue to mount publicity in public education on a meals scheme for members of the public to have a better idea of the energy performance of appliances so that they will be able to choose energy-efficient products in order to help save energy. We appeal to members for your continuous support, as well as support for the proposed phase 4 of meals. All right, two members have indicated their wish to speak. We have 5 minutes for each, starting with Dr. Loai Kwok. Thank you, Chairman. For the previous phases of meals, I think that members of the public and consumers have got used to the idea. So I don't think there'll be a lot of problem in covering more products under phase 4 of meals. That is because, basically, these are not leaders in the market. We're just following the market trend, be it LED lamps, gas cookers, gas instantaneous water heaters. Even if we have local manufacturers, they target not only the local market, but other markets. That is why they need to fulfill the energy labeling requirements in other places as well. At the same time, many consumers would buy imported appliances. So my question is about the market situation. Definitely, the Bureau and the departments would have some idea of the market situation. And basically, these three types of appliances will be meeting your energy efficiency standards. Is that right? Second question. About other economies. Now, there are some familiar places which already have mandatory energy and efficiency labeling schemes in place. Take mainland as an example. They have mandatory energy labeling schemes for these types, three types of appliances already. So appliances sold in Hong Kong would similarly be subject to the similar labeling scheme requirement on the mainland. In other words, they should be exempted from undergoing tests again in order to confirm that they meet the standards. These are the two questions. Undersecretary. Of course, in the market, there is a great variety of appliances meeting our standards. But from experience, after we launched the meals scheme, consumers would opt for more energy efficient appliances. So the market landscape may change. Appliances that are not energy efficient will gradually be phased out. As for the testing standards, I've deferred to the EMSD colleagues. Chairman, about the three proposed appliances, at the moment they are covered under the voluntary scheme. And in the voluntary scheme, there is a schedule that refer to the energy performance of these products. Comparing those to the proposed standards, for LED lamps, as an example, we have grades 1 to 3 forming the majority of products in the market. Through legislative amendments, we seek to further improve the energy-saving performance of LED lamps. As for gas cookers and gas instantaneous water heaters, the majority of them are either grade 1 or grade 2. And through this exercise, we hope to make these gas appliances more energy efficient. So all in all, the electric appliances sold in the market at the moment could meet our standards. In other words, the government has already sounded out the market and found that the products should be able to meet the meals requirement. So from what you said, it seems that phase 4 shouldn't pose any extra burden on the market or have any negative impact on the market. Rather, I see some benefits because from my observation, if we go to a shop, consumers are discerning enough to check the energy efficiency labels and go for more efficient ones. So we're in phase 4. I don't think there'll be a lot of difficulties for implementation. I'm going to support it. Mr. Tony Chair. Basically, I support meals and more products should be covered to allow consumers to make informed choices. My question is this. These three products earlier already in were included in the voluntary scheme. And for gas cooker and residential gas instantaneous water heaters, the voluntary labeling scheme has lapsed on the 30th of June, and for LED lamp, up to the end of December 2023, a bit longer. My question is this. The voluntary energy efficiency labeling scheme started in 2013. It's been many years. Now the transitional arrangement proposed is 15 to 18 months. Because the voluntary scheme has been in place for a long time, so why not longer?
With the inclusion of these products in the voluntary labeling scheme, when you make the inclusion mandatory, what would happen in the meantime, consumers might wonder that the products would become more inferior during the transitional period. And do you have any plans on that? You would conduct testing every year. What percentage of the products would be tested, and how many or what percentage of the products fail the test? You would engage companies to conduct tests. How would the government ensure the quality of the testing work? I would defer to the MSC. On the transitional arrangements, in the first three phases, we provided a transitional period of 18 months. We communicated the issue with the trades through our task forces, and the eight types of appliances covered earlier were all gas appliances, and this time we covered two types of gas appliances, and that is why the trades urge us to be prudent with the arrangements, because it takes time for them to adapt to the latest requirement and standards, and some time is needed for them to clear their existing stock. So we will maintain communication with the trade with an eye to shortening the transitional period as much as possible. For the VEAL scheme, as we transition into a mandatory labeling scheme, during the transitional period, we would gradually move towards the mandatory scheme from the voluntary scheme. The voluntary scheme adopted a confirmatory approach, and we will move towards a mandatory approach. So the energy efficiency labeling arrangements under MEALS would be the same as VEALS in order to provide for a smooth transition. That is our goal. VEALS expired on June the 30th, so would the voluntary requirements become mandatory automatically, such that the labels would remain? Otherwise, consumers might be confused about the labels. The voluntary labels would be modified to become mandatory energy efficiency labels. So products that are yet to attain the requirements could be identified easily. The voluntary scheme expired on June the 30th already, so I'd like to clarify the arrangements. After we report the proposal to members today, we intend to update VEALS. And later this month or in August, we will disclose the proposed details to the trades and the testing standards and methodology between VEALS and MEALS would be equivalent. I think the preparation work is extremely poor. You knew that you would be moving towards a mandatory scheme. If you drag your feet in the upgrading exercise, those who did not take part in the voluntary labeling scheme would have time to get rid of their stock, while those who took part in the voluntary scheme would lose out. Currently, the requirement is only voluntary, but you should allow those products to be accredited under the new mandatory scheme. Otherwise, consumers would be in the dark. You're talking about a transitional period of more than 10 months, and consumers would be left in the dark in the meantime. Chairman, we hear members' views, but as the EMSD suggested, with members' support in the proposal, we will start discussing the voluntary scheme with the trades and update the relevant requirements immediately. If you minimize the transitional period, that would be better for everyone. Mr. Kwai Kang, I have two questions. The energy efficiency labeling scheme has been in place for a number of years. How many contraventions were detected and what kind of punishments were handed down? I'd like to know the progress of the enforcement work. I'm sure no one would object to providing more information to consumers, but according to paragraphs 13 and 14, for gas cookers and gas instantaneous water heaters, you have arrangements in place. But for LED lamps, the work is somewhat difficult, and you need to allow the trades to discuss the arrangements. And how long would the discussions take? A lot of sellers have a lot of stock of these products, while many consumers would buy their appliances online. So for products sold online, do you require the sellers to include the energy efficiency label on the relevant websites, and is this covered in the legislation? For certain chandelier products, light bulbs are included, and when the legislation is enacted, what needs to be done on these products? For LED lamps attached to these chandeliers, would the products have to carry the relevant labels as well? I would defer to the MSC. In terms of prosecutions, as of May this year, since the label was put in place, 410 stores were inspected. 8,374 complied with the labeling requirements. We issued 76 objection notices, and we prosecuted 26 suppliers for breaching the requirements. They were fined levels between $1,000 and $15,000 respectively. For products sold online, they would need to comply with the legislation as well. That is, they must first obtain product reference number and labels, and the labels must be affixed on the products before they could be sold. With the online sales becoming more and more popular starting from year 2017, local shopping websites would be inspected on a regular basis to see whether local retailers were complying with our requirements. In past inspections, We identified contraventions, in one of the cases, we initiated prosecution, and the seller was convicted. And if we detect further contraventions, we would follow up and take action accordingly. For LED lamps already attached to electrical appliances, would the relevant products have to obtain a fresh label? For LED lamps, we would comply with the international IEC 62612 standards. And the test will cover products with LED bulbs. For LED lamps under 60 watts, they make up 99% of the market share. So we would be focusing on these LED lamps. For LED lighting appliances, currently there are no testing standards in place. And if there are new international standards on those products, they would be incorporated as well. For night sensors designed for elderly people, are they covered by the scheme? We are referring to lights that operate on batteries, and they would turn on when someone passes by. For screw-on LED bulbs, they would be included in the test. For other types, they would not be covered. The scheme only applies to screw-on bulbs. Mr. Peter Xu. This exercise is about phase four of meals. The first three phases of the scheme were rolled out since 2018. The objective of the scheme is to provide an indication on energy consumption with different energy appliances, and the greater the energy efficiency, the more people can save in terms of electricity tariffs, and they are also more environmentally friendly. So this is certainly worth supporting. In the first three phases of the scheme, they covered appliances such as washing machines and TV sets, and the trades have been very supportive of the scheme, and they must include the relevant ratings on the label. And manufacturers were able to find out how much electricity is consumed by the appliances compared with their competitors. And I believe market competition is not just based on price, and manufacturers have to think about energy consumption as well. Appliances that consume too much energy would not be popular with consumers. And the result is that consumers or manufacturers would strive to produce more energy efficient products, and this would only be good news for everyone. In the first three phases of the scheme, they have proved popular with the public, and the trades also welcome the scheme. And the EMSD and EBD have maintained close communication with different trades by providing transitional periods. And the labeling scheme was rolled out in phases to provide for an adaptation period for manufacturers. So all in all, there was very good collaboration between the government and the trades. And in the first three phases of the scheme, I consulted the trades whether they had any comments, and I was rather surprised. Normally, they have a lot to say about different bills, and the reason was that they were amply consulted by the government, and they came up with a consensus on many different aspects, so it was certainly a good thing.
So, for the first three phases, I didn't hear any objection from the industry. For phase four, I also consulted the trade associations in relation to LED lamps, etc., whether they have views on the proposed products to be covered. They do not have strong views. So since I represent the sector and there is no strong view, I don't have strong views either. Just keep up the good work. Anything to supplement? Thank you, member, for the comments, and we'll continue to liaise with the sector and continue to improve. Next, Dr. Junis Ho. Thank you, Chairman. This is phase four of Mandatory Energy Efficiency Labelling Scheme. I'd like to give my full support, but Secretary, can you give us some indicators? On the 4th of November 2016, we joined the Paris Agreement with a view to reduce carbon emission. So just now we discussed the Clean Air Plan for Hong Kong. We also have the Climate Action Plan for Hong Kong 2030, and this is an item on phase four of meals. And we all have the same objective, that is to reduce carbon emission. And we would like to have global collaboration to reduce the global temperature by 2 degrees Celsius. Back then, it was 6.2 tons per carbon emission, and by 2030, the per capita carbon emission could be reduced to 3.3 or 3.8. And this is also information I found on your website. And according to Paris Agreement in 2019, we should conduct an interim review and then subsequent interim reviews all the way to 2030. Protecting the environment is a long-term battle. Do you have indicators? What are the indicators? How are we faring comparing to the Paris Agreement? Because on municipal solid waste charging scheme last time, I talked about the various measures rolled out, and I had to know the objective and the cost effectiveness, and I was given a table, and I am satisfied with it because it provides a holistic picture of your target and the objectives you have in mind and whether we're achieving those objectives. So could you please give us more information in relation to the Paris Agreement? We have 440,000 tons of carbon emission saved, and I'll be able to save 75,000 tons of carbon emission by including the three types of products in phase four. So by the end of 2021, how do we fare per capita? Are we at 4.3 or 3.9? Because we're supposed to reach 4.5 tons by the end of 2029. Have we reached that? We don't have data for 2020 yet. For 2019, we were close to 4.5 tons. So we're quite confident that in 2020, we should be able to meet the target. Where do I see that? We were close to 4.5 tons in 2019. We published the figures last week, all right. So it took us a long time before getting the data for 2019. because we need to collect information from various stakeholders. So usually it would take about 1 year to 1.5 years of time lag. That's the practice around the world as well. But then technology is advancing. We have supercomputers, and we also have data available by implementing, say, waste charging schemes. We should be able to get live data. I thought we were advanced enough, just like punching figures in the ATM machine. If I only knew by the end of the year whether I had sufficient balance in the current account, then I might OD any minute. So I really can't accept it. You said we were close to 4.5 at the end of 2019, but the figure wasn't published until last week. So we're in July 2021, the 19th of July 2021, in fact. I understand that, Dr. Ho, but then if we are to have accurate figures, we need to wait for information to be provided by stakeholders, and that means a time lag. If we take a look at the power generated, the fuel consumed, we can prepare estimates. And as I said just now, we're confident that in 2020, we would have been able to achieve the targets as well. I just want to speed things up because we're all concerned about environmental protection. We have audited accounts and managed accounts in accountancy. So at least I have a rough idea, even for unaudited accounts. For the 2019 figure, it should have been published latest by the first quarter of 2020. Can you speed things up? Because for the 2020 report, I don't know when it will be ready. Our practice is around the middle of this year. So that means by the middle of next year? Yes, in mid-year, we would announce figures relating to the previous year. It's just a ballpark figure that we could be ready. Well, if we are to reduce the per capita carbon emission to 3.3 by 2030, according to the Paris Agreement, how are we going to report to the world? Well, we have a Hong Kong Climate Change Action Plan 2030, and by 2030, the carbon emission intensity should be reduced by 65%. But of course, this is something yet to happen. And the chief executive has actually announced that we will be reaching carbon neutrality by 2050. I think you missed my question. It's pointless to talk about targets. I'm talking about the homework you should have handed in. You should have handed in your homework at 3 p.m. and said, you now say sorry, it won't be ready until 6 p.m. Now, we're supposed to meet the target by 2030, but when do we know whether we are meeting the targets? Does it mean that you the report won't be ready until 2032? The Paris Agreement requires all participating countries, and Hong Kong, not so much a country, but a participating state, to submit a report. It's not an annual progress report, but rather a report once every 5 years. You still don't get it. I am saying that you should speed it up. I don't care if it's 3 or 5 years a report. That's exactly my comment. It's not that we're required to submit the report by the end of 2030 if we want to publish figures about 2030. There's no such requirement? No. Now, the state members should formulate a plan, and that's for 2030. We now have another plan for with a horizon until 2050, and we're going to announce this plan later this year. Yes, thank you, Chairman. As for progress report, we need to submit a report once every 5 years. There will be ample time for that. So I do hope the administration could give us information in a timely manner, because the panel otherwise won't understand where we're heading. We're supposed to adjourn the meeting at 6:30. Mr. Tony Chair. Yes, one simple question. We asked about random checks. Random inspections by engaging an independent third party. What is the difference? Just to make sure that the quality is sound. You use the heat energy as a basis of grading the energy level in the label, or thermal efficiency. For gas cooker, the thermal efficiency may be 66%. The other one may be some 90%. Have you considered IC cookers, gas cookers, whether there are comparable ratings for consumers to choose, whether either product is more energy efficient? I'll defer to the EMSD to take your question. About random checks, every year we consider the products in the schedule, and 5% of the products in the schedule will be subject to random checks. Say if it's kept at 5% and in the following year we have 500 new products on the schedule, then at least 25 will be chosen. For the so-called independent laboratory, we commissioned the laboratory, and then our colleagues would work with the lab staff. We would procure products from the market for the purpose of random checked, and they would be tested in laboratory immediately. In other words, the whole process will not be rigged. About thermal efficiency, we note that we have electric water heaters, IC cookers, and they boil water in different manners. For electric heaters, coils should be used to directly convert electric energy into thermal energy. So in terms of efficiency, it should be higher. For gas heaters, now inevitably, in generating gas, the certain energy will be lost in the atmosphere. So the thermal efficiency would be 90% if you want to have a great one. Whereas that's for the case for electric heaters. For gas heaters, the great one means somewhere around 60% of thermal efficiency. So you can just take a look at the labels. If you're talking about grade 1 label, then it's already the best among the same type of products. Say if you use a gas cooker, and if you want to compare gas cooker with an IC cooker, I don't know whether it's comparable. It is not as technical, because different households may have different preference in terms of cooking. They might find it more appealing to use open flame cooking. So because of the different uses, it's very difficult to make objective comparison. But basically, you can compare the thermal efficiency, is that right? Let me supplement. If you use a gas cooker, you use open flame for cooking, and if you use an electric cooker or IC cooker, there is open flame in a sense that it comes from the power plant. So if you consider the efficiency, I would say that overall speaking, they should be comparable. Now, I see coca may give you an impression that it's more efficient, but in fact not. It depends on your cooking style and the type of appliance you choose. All right, we have had a very fruitful discussion, and I think the government has already explained very clearly their paper submitted, so I think we should wrap up the item now.
Any
comments from members on the legislative proposal? All right. Next item, any other business? If there's no AOB, the meeting is adjourned. Thank you.